motivation lecture, what does it do?
Mm.
You know, you rather have a workshop where, you know, you have people who specialize. Let me tell you, not everyone needs to specialize. Number two is, if you want me to talk, I'll ask you, did the Prophet ﷺ have workshops or give lectures?
Mm.
Tell me.
Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, yani, he spoke to the Sahaba.
He did khutab on Jum'ah, he did khutab on the things, he taught the people. Because he was so powerful, it was the lectures. But the specialized learning happened through those lectures as well. The way we have categorized it now, we cannot call it a bid'ah because it's a wasila, it's just wasail.
Yes.
But if someone wants to be hard and fast, they could tell you that's not the prophetic way.
Yeah.
I won't say that. We need the workshops, we need the lectures, we need the training courses, we need the holiday lessons, we need the weekly, we need the study, we need the school, we need the everything we need. I'm not one. But if you're going to attack me, if I've come to your community and I don't have the time to conduct a workshop, why do you want to attack me?
Mm-hmm.
I could refute you, and I could actually refute you so badly, I promise you. If I start refuting and I get into this engage, I'm losing focus. I've got bigger things to do. Wallahi.
It could be a prof from Shaitan.
Allah's given me this day. Today, I will tick off what I've done in mental tick off. And I need today to be better than yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to waste my time with negativity. You can think bad of me, khalas, it's up to you. Think bad of me. It's not going to reduce the price of eggs that I'm going to buy from the store. Or increase. You know what I mean? It's got nothing to do. So if the only thing is when people become violent, like I've had death threats from our own people.
Really?
They call you a murtad, they call you a mushrik, they call you a kafir, they call you a fasiq. They've even tried it. I've had people who've actually shot at me.
Inna lillahi.
So
this was a couple of years ago.
Yes, I
remember hearing it. I thought it was fake news.
No, it wasn't fake news. And that's
why,
the reason.
What was the reason for that?
Just because they believe you're a mushrik or you're a murtad or you're a Gustakhi Rasul, they say, you know, you insult the Prophet by this. And it's a legitimate difference of opinion, but, you know, people are quick to remove others from the fold of Islam. So I've tasted what takfir would actually do when it's just loosely thrown out. I've tasted what it will do, because even the best of us would actually just be, that itself is what you call extremism, you know, when you don't think of what you're saying, that where it's going to lead to, because one person says something, and they think they're doing a good deed, they think they're doing da'wah, etc. But how the others will translate it is very different. They'll add one and one and make a natija of five. And they'll take it in their own hands to go and harm and attack a person. And they've done it to me.
Wow.
Just because of...
Was that in your country? Or
No, in South Africa.
No.
Wow.
Yeah, and I've never been back to that place after that, but I'm going to go back now in January.
We can come back, inshallah. We'll get the boys there.
Really,
to protect you.
You know, to be honest, yeah, and I think even those people have realized that, no, this guy is not what we thought he was. And I think they've realized that. And it was easy for me to actually have taken that and made a big noise of it, and probably gone into the courts. But for what? You're gonna start getting two camps of Muslimin fighting each other, and when the followers get involved, they make it worse than the principals.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Yeah. It's like any of the mashayikh. You see, nice guys.
Mm.
Some of their followers are worse than anything that they would ever have allowed. But they're claiming to be followers of that sheikh. I've seen that a lot.
What advice would you give, as a final question, because I know
we're pressed for time.
What advice would you, general advice, would you give Muslims in the West who are facing those difficulties that you talked about? I was reading something from Pew Research that said in America 24% of Muslims apostate in America. I think you're seen as a beacon of light in the sense that you kind of unify the people and you've brought a lot of, maybe you've curtailed that number. What advice, final advice would you give?
Okay, my job is normally to reach out to people who are quite weak. But I want to encourage them. I want to identify the good in them. Because look, my brother, everyone has good and bad.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just that one is more than the other. Some have, and I have a job of identifying goodness in a person. So even if I see someone who looks apparently far from the deen,
mm-hmm.
I'll try and say a word that will make them feel, gosh, you know, I'm actually a Muslim. I'm a Muslim, you know, because I know the impact of that. Instead of me picking on something and saying, you know what, that's it, you know, because we chase the people away. So when you say people apostate, a lot of the times it's because of us chasing them away, because of we're not considerate of their situation. And I've said that earlier on today, that, you know, we're not considerate of their situation. So we start saying things that are hurtful. And then you have others who are telling them good words. So then they go towards it. As much as we say Islam is the fastest growing religion in the globe, I want to tell you something that I've studied.
Mm.
I've studied.
Mm-hmm.